you people will be having exam on when? When is your exams? You are having on 28th and 29th, I guess. Your exams? 29th. Okay. So 28th and 29th. Okay, so let's see. So I think so you could have taken feedbacks from your friends. How's the paper and all? Have you gone through any kind of paper before PCS paper? Till now there are many slots done, like 24, 25, 26, 27. Even today also they have there are many slots done. Yes, voice is low. Yeah. Okay. So I'll be picking up few questions that has been appeared recently in this examination, and we will solve them. Okay. The questions are actually not that difficult. They are little easy itself. So let's see. We'll solve few questions and we will understand how what kind of questions they gave, and you will get a clear picture about that. Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So you guys can use the chat box itself. Everyone mute yourself. So there is only one meeting. So even I will be going, I'll do the meeting by mobile. So you guys can use the chat box. So everyone please mute itself so that the class will go in a peaceful manner. Okay, so let me show you few of the questions that has been occurred in TCS exam which has been conducted recently. Okay. So first of all, we'll be discussing quantitative ability and we'll be even discussing logical also. Okay. So as you all know, quants, there will be 26 questions and you will be getting 40 minutes of time for that, and there will be even calculator also for you. Okay, and this time there has been concentrated more on problems of statistics, data interpretations, profit and loss was more, and even time, speed and distance, time and work, all of these concepts are also more. Okay, so let's quickly go through them. Even from ratios and proportions also there are good number of questions. Okay, so let's see what are the models that came. So here is the first question. So the question is going to be from profit and loss, and this was occurred in 27th today in the morning slot of 8 to 11 o'clock. Okay, so here is the first question. So the question is saying A sells an article to B at a profit of 15% and B sells to C by making it a profit of 20%. If C paid rupees 690, what is the original price of the article? So they're asking us what is the original price. Means we are supposed to calculate how much A received. So this was occurred on today morning slot. Okay. So even from profit and loss also, there are good number of questions. You can expect minimum 2 to 3 questions from profit and loss also. I want everyone to have a pen and paper with you so that you can also practice along with me. I hope everyone is carrying that. Okay. So let's all. Okay, so firstly, I'll tell you how to solve the question. So A is going to sell an article to B, and that too with the profit of 15%. Okay, and then B is going to sell to C, and that too a profit of 20%. Okay, now C is going to receive for rupees 690, and we are supposed to calculate what is the original price of the article. So first of all, what is happening here is there are three transactions going on. Okay, so, sorry, actually there are three persons, but only two transactions, A to B and from B to C, right? So you can actually do this type of questions in two models. Okay, so everyone, please mute yourself. You can use the chat box. Okay, so actually you can do it in two models. I'll say you both the models. Okay. And let's see. So first model is, you can imagine A bought it for some X rupees. Okay, I'm just imagining A will buy it for some X rupees. Okay, so now what is going to happen? If A buy it for X rupees, A is going to sell B for a profit of 15%. Means for X rupees, 15% more. Means it is going to become like X plus 15% of X will be added. That is profit. So 15% will be added to that. Okay, so X plus 15% of X it will become. So now you can calculate what is this. So X plus 15% is nothing but 15 divided by 100 into X. So X plus, this is nothing but 0.15X, and total will give you 1.15X. Okay, so this is what B is going to receive. Okay, so now what is going to happen? B is going to sell it to C by making a profit of 20%. And one more thing, you will be having calculator also. So make use of calculator. Don't sit and waste your time in calculation part also. You can make use of calculator. Okay, so here what is happening? B is going to sell C. Means you are supposed to consider the value of B. How much is B here? 1.15X. Than this 20% more. Means it will be 1.15X plus 20% of 1.15X it will become. Okay, so for this 20% will be added, not anymore on X. So you can calculate this value. Calculators will be there. Make use of that. Don't forget it. So it will become 1.15X plus 0.23X. Okay, so 20% is, just write it as 20 divided by 100 into 1.15X. So this entire will give us 1.38X. So this is the amount where C will get. So now C is going to get for rupees 690, means definitely 1.38X should be equals to 690 rupees, because C is going to pay 1.38X rupees. So that should be equals to 690, means X will be equals to 690 divided by 1.38. Okay, so it will nothing but it will give us 500. So make use of the calculator. So X will be equals to 500, means nothing but option B. So what's my answer? It's option B, 500. So this is, most of you have said the answer. Yes, Aishwarya, Ali, Giri, and Shavana, correct? Okay, so this is one method that you can do. X, and you can do it as X plus 15%, and you can do it as X plus 1.15X plus 20%, like this. And one more small method you can do is, remember this one, not only for this particular model, you can use it for any other profit and loss problems also. So what I'll do is, I'll imagine A bought it for 100 rupees. I'm just imagining A will buy it for 100 rupees. Now what will happen? A is going to sell for B for 15%. So for 100, 15% of 100 will be added. So what is 15% of 100? 15% of 100 is nothing but 15 rupees. Means it will become 115 now. So B will buy it for 115 rupees. Now what is going to happen? 115, yes, correct, Sagar. So 115. Now what is going to happen? B is going to sell for C for 20% more. Means 115 plus 20% of 115 will be added to this. Okay. So 20% of 115. So first of all, 115, 20% you can calculate. And that will give you 23. So 23 plus 115 means 138 rupees it will become. Okay. So here you just imagine in terms of X, and here we are imagining in terms of 100. So if I imagine it is 100, C should get 138. So if it is 100, it is 138 rupees. But it is not 100 now. And that too, it is not 138, it is 160 now. So if it is 160, If it is 690, how much? You can just imagine x and you can do cross multiplication. So x will be equals to 690 into 100 divided by 138, which will again give you 500. Both will give you the same answer. One thing we will imagine as x and we will do, and next case we will just imagine it as 100 and we will do. Okay. Sagar, which method you want me to repeat? The first method or the second method? Okay. Okay, I hope first method everyone could understand, because I just went by using x. So I imagine x and I did. So you guys can easily do that. Now, I'll tell you the second method, sure. So what we are going to do is A, B and C, there are three numbers. So I'll just imagine A buy it for 100 rupees. I'm just imagining it as 100, okay? Actually, it is not 100, I'm just imagining 100. 100, why? Because easy for calculation, that's it. That is the only reason why always we used to take 100. Now what is going to happen? B will receive for 15% of profit. A is going to sell for B for 15% of profit. Means 100 plus 15% of 100, right? So 15% of 100 is nothing but 15 rupees. Means B will buy it for 115 rupees, okay? So B for 115. Now B is going to sell C for 20% of profit. Means 115 plus 20% of 115. Okay, so 115 plus 20% of 115 more. So now what is going to happen? This is 115 and 20% of 115 means nothing but 20 divided by 100 into 115, right? So you can calculate this one. This will give you 23. So total 138. Now, if A is 100, B will be 115 and C will be 138. Yes. So now what is going to happen is 138. So if it is 100, then it will be 138. But actually it is not 100 and this is not 138. He is going to receive for 690. Means C value is 690 and I don't know how much this is. So let me imagine this is some X. So I'll just do cross multiplication to find the value of A. So X will be equals to 690 into 690 into 100 divided by 138, which will give us 500. So just do cross multiplication, that's it. Actually, if it is 100, it should be 138, but it is not 100. It is the value we don't know, and it is not 138, it is 690. Jamil, actually, I did the same thing. So it will give us 500. Sagar and Shavana, I think it was clear now. So let's see the next one. So here is the next question. Yes, Preeti, we move to the next. So the collection of numbers which comprises the data given below is arranged in ascending order 3, 7, 9, n minus 5, 15, 18, 19, and 20. If the median of the data is 12.5, what is the value of n? So they're asking us to calculate the value of n. So firstly, what is meaning of median? So we should know how to calculate the median. Okay, yeah, most of you are giving the answers. Good. So how to calculate median firstly? So first of all, median always depends upon the number of numbers. So how many numbers are there here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 numbers are there, right? So it is nothing but even. If it is odd, you can directly pick up the median as your middle number. If it is even, it will be average of middle numbers again. So what are the middle numbers here? N minus 1 and 15. Yes, very good. Almost all of you are saying the answer. So it is nothing. Median is nothing but sum of middle numbers. Sum of middle numbers divided by 2 should be equals to median. If it is only odd, then it will be directly middle number. But here there are two middle numbers, so we'll take like this. So sum of middle numbers is how much? N minus 1 plus 15 divided by 2 should be equals to 12.5. So N minus 1 plus 15 will be equals to 25. So N plus 14 will be equals to 25. That implies N will be equals to 11. So what's the middle one? 11. Okay, and one more thing you guys should remember is actually middle thing is correct, but some in this particular thing they has given ascending order directly. Some cases they will not give you ascending order. They'll give you in a zigzag manner and they will ask you to find the median. At that moment, first arrange them in ascending order. Okay, and then only calculate the middle one. Okay, just check that one. So always it should be in ascending order and then only you can calculate it. Okay, so first thing is that. So here already it is. So I'm not going to waste my time. I'll directly pick the middle numbers. Okay, so here is the next question. After purchasing two copies of same book, X sold them respectively at 0.8 and 1.4 times their cost price. What was the percentage gain and or loss incurred by X? So gain or loss by X here they're saying. Okay, so as most of you are answering, I'll give you 1 minute of time. Try the question. This is going to fall on profit and loss concept itself again. Okay, 10% loss, 5% gain. Okay, different answers. Okay. Oh, yes. Yes, Ajay. The record will be uploaded. Okay. Now, fine. Most of you are saying it is option C and few are saying 20% gain. Durga, option is also not there, 20%. Okay. So let's see, I think answer C or 3 will be correct. Okay, so let's all. So you can actually do this also in two methods. I think almost all of you has did this problem before. That is the reason just by seeing the question, most of you are answering. So let's see. So firstly, we can do it in two methods. So one, you can imagine the cost to price as some X, or you can imagine the cost to price as some amount. Like 100 rupees or 200 rupees like that, I'm going to imagine some amount. So I'll imagine my cost to price is equals to 100 rupees. Okay, so let me just imagine cost to price is 100 rupees. But here there are two copies of same book, means definitely both will be 100 and 100. So you buy two copies, means you are going to invest 200 rupees actually, 100 and 100. Okay, so now what is going to happen? X is going to sell them respectively at 0.8 and 1.4 times the cost to price. So first case, it is 0.8 times the cost to price, means 0.8 into cost to price. So it will be 0.8 into 100, means it is going to be for 80 rupees. So first it is going to be 80 rupees. Similarly, let's do the second one. So here SP will become 1.4 into 100, means 140 rupees. Now I'm supposed to find my overall total percentage of profit or loss. So total percentage means CP here is 100 and here it is 100, means total cost to price. So total cost to price will be 200, because 100 plus 100 will give you 200, right? So for total cost price will be 200 and total selling price. So let me take total selling price will be equals to 80 and 140 will be nothing but 220. So if you see, definitely selling price is more here, means definitely I'm going to get a profit. So let me calculate how much that profit will be. Percentage of profit formula is nothing but SP minus CP divided by CP into 100. So SP is how much? 220 divided by 200 divided by 200 into 100. So this and this will get cancelled. 20 divided by 2 is nothing but 10%. So 10% of profit. So 10% of profit is nothing but option C. So first one, it is 10% of loss. So it will be option C. Actually, this time TCS said the exam will be adaptive exam, but actually according to the question paper, it's not like adaptive, it's a normal exam itself. So you can answer all the questions. There will be no negative marking. So don't leave any question. Even if you don't get the answer also, just give it a try. Okay, because there is no negative marking, right? So you guys can attempt all the questions. Yeah, I hope this question was clear for all, because all of you has answered already. So let's move ahead to the next question. I hope so. The people who has said the wrong answer, a few has answered it as option A and option B. So please cross check. So let's see the next question. So here is the next question. So this question is going to fall in the category of mensurations. So yeah, we were trying the radius. The diameter of a pizza is 30 centimeter. Diameter of pizza is given. What is the area of the upper surface of the hectare in of the pizza whose arc length is 8 centimeter? Okay, so good. Most of you are answering very fast. Maybe you has also already gone through the papers. Okay, yes, sing. Yes, so there is a formula. The area is nothing. Area will be equals to length of the arc into radius of the arc divided by 2. So this is the formula. Length of the arc is already given as 8 into radius. Diameter is 30, so radius will be half of that. So 30 divided by 2 is nothing but 15. So radius will be 15 divided by 2. So force, and it will give you 60. So 60 centimeter square. So answer is 460. Yes, this is the formula. Length of the arc into radius of the arc divided by 2. Yes, good. Length of the arc into radius of the arc divided by 2. Okay, fine. So let me give you one interesting question. So let's see how many of you can solve. Most of you are, I think most of you has already went through the questions. So let's see. I'll give you F. Okay, so X plus 10% is, this also occurred in TCS itself. I'm not creating any question now. If X plus 10% is of 240 is 60% more than X percent is of 180. So this is the statement given. X plus 10% is of 240, 60% more than X percent is of 180. Then we are supposed to calculate 150% is of X plus 20 is what percentage of 25% of X? Okay, actually this question is not there in the slide. That is the reason I just wrote it. Okay, so this is also most of your answering 15% is, 16% is. Good, Vaishnavi, definitely you could have gone through before. Yes, 16% is. Don't buy hack the values. I hope you guys practice them and you are answering. Fine. So let's see. So X plus 10% is of 240 was equals to 60% is of 60% is more than X percent is of 180, right? So this is going to become, I'm going to write directly as most of you has answered it. So X plus 10% is of 240 will be equals to 60% is more. If you has attended already the percentages class, everyone knows the answer, ma'am, but only solved few. Okay, you should not by heart the answer because maybe the values changed. Okay, so let's see. So if you has already attended the classes, I has already said you, if it is 60% is more or 60% is less like that, what you should do is you should add it to 100, or if it is more, add it to 100. If it is less, subtract it from 100, like that. Okay, means here it is 60% is more, means it is nothing but 160%. So I'm directly writing it as 1.6, 160. So into X percentage means again X percentage, I'll write this as 1.8 into X. So this is what they are saying here. So this will give us this is x plus 10 divided by 100, right? So this will give us 2.4x plus 24 will be equals to 1.6 into 1.8x. So here if we calculate, 24 will be equals to 0.48x. So you will be having calculator, so make use of calculators also. So by this, I'll get my x value as 50. Okay, but what they're asking, then they are asking me 15% of x plus 20 means x plus 20 means it is nothing but 70. In 70, 15% I should calculate. So 70 into 15 means nothing but 10.5. So this particular thing will be 10.5. So here it is 10.5. And let me calculate even this also. 25% of x. X is 50, 25% is nothing but 12.5. So they're asking how much will be this percentage. So what is the difference here? 12.5 and yeah. So it will be nothing but 12.5 minus 10.5 divided by 12.5 into 100. So this will give you 15%. Yes, 15% is correct. I hope most of you already went through that, but I want you people even to know the method. Okay, just don't just by heart. So 16% is correct. Okay, cool. So let's see the next question. Please don't by heart. Okay, so here is the next question. Yes, you can take a look. Take a minute of time, try it. Finally, I can see a question with late responses. Good. Okay. 3-4% loss. Fine. Let's see. 4% loss or 4% gain? I'm not exactly sure. Okay. 4% loss. Okay, so only 3 responses. Okay, so let's see. Actually, we can do in various methods this particular problem. We can imagine X and we can do, or we can imagine 100 and we can do. Everything is a lengthy, but I'll say you an easiest method. And you guys remember, you can apply this particular method only for this kind of problems. Okay, so try to concentrate. So an item was sold for profit of 12% after giving a discount of 12.5%. Means after giving a discount of 12.5%, that is going to get a profit of 12%. Okay. So now I'm supposed to find what will be the gain or loss percentage if the discount is 25%. Now, instead of 12.5%, I'm going to give a discount of 25%. Okay, so let's see. So first step to remember is discount will always be given on MRP, and profit or loss will always occur on cost price. The first thing, discount will always be on MRP and profit and loss will always be on cost price. So now if you see, this particular thing is going to get a profit of 12%. So main thing, whenever it is profit, add it to 100. So you will just add it to 100. Whenever it is discount or loss, subtract it from 100. Remember this shortcut. Okay, not only for TCS I'm saying you in generally also. Even Wipro is coming up and Accenture is also coming up, right? So yeah, try to learn aptitude and logical. Don't just go only with the company. So just remember this one. Whenever it is profit, add it to 100. Whenever it is loss or discount, subtract it from 100. If you can remember the small things, you can easily solve any kind of problems in profit and loss. So I'm going to apply the same kind of stuff in this particular kind of problem. Okay. So first case, I'm going to get a profit of 12%. It is profit, So add it to 100 means the SP here will become 112% of CP. Profit will come from CP. So CP I'm considering. It is profit. That is the reason I add it to 100. 12% of profit. So 100 plus 12, 112. Next. Next, what is going to happen? Discount of 12.5%. Discount means what I am supposed to do. I am supposed to subtract from 100, right? So 100 minus 12.5 we are supposed to do. Means it is nothing but here SP will be, actually they both are same. So here it will be 87.5% of discount will come on MRP. So it will be 87.5% of MRP. So main thing here is, 87.5% when you sell, you are going to get 112%. So 112%. If I am going to reduce 87.5%, it will be 112%. Now, I don't know what is my profit percentage. So profit means this percentage, right? So let us imagine this is X. So here I'm going to get a discount of 25%. So now you guys say me 25% means discount of 25% means how much should I consider? 25% of discount. So discount means what I should do? I should subtract from 100. Yes. So how much should I consider? I should consider it as
25.
Yes. So just do cross multiplication now. So this is 75%. So just find X value and answer will be done. So X will be equals to 112 into 75 divided by 87.5. Okay, make use of calculators. Calculators are available on your screen, so make use of them. So this will give us 96%. Okay, so X is 96%, means nothing but 96% of CP. Okay, so I got this one, but now how can I identify whether it is loss or profit? It is very simple. Make it 100 plus or 100 minus something. Whatever you get, you should write it as 100 plus or minus. Here, actually, 112 is nothing but 100 plus 12. Plus indicates profit. That is the reason 12% profit. Now, how can I write 96? It is nothing but 100 minus 4. So, minus indicates it is loss. Means there is 4% of loss. So, my answer will become option C. Whatever you get here, write it in terms of 100 plus or 100 minus. So it can be definitely written only in terms of 100 minus. So 100 minus 4 will be the correct one. Okay. So it will be nothing but option 3, 4% of loss. Do you people understood this model? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, cool. So just remember this one. Discount or loss, subtract from 100. Profit, add it to 100. So here is the next. Last part, you got 96% of CP, right? So whatever you get in, now, whatever you get here, write it in terms of 100 plus or minus. Okay, for example, I got here 96. So 96 can be written as 100 plus or minus means it can be written as 100 minus 4 means it is minus indicates it is loss. And how much this is? This is 4. So 4% of loss. For example, I got 108 means it will be 100 plus 8 means 8% of profit. It is addition of profit. For example, you got 76 means it is nothing but 100 minus 24 means minus it is 24% loss like that. So whenever you get whatever the answer you get, just write it in terms of 100 plus or 100 minus. I hope you understood now. Okay, so here is the next question. What is the fourth proportion of 0.006 and 1.2 and 6 divided by 25? They're asking us to calculate fourth proportion. Yeah, give it a try. I think most of you has already practiced. Oh, 48 or 4.8. I think 48 is correct. I'm not sure. Okay, so let's see, 48. Okay, so first of all, this is going to fall under the case of ratios and proportions. So fourth proportion. So firstly, fourth proportion means first there will be four terms like this, A, B, C and D. Okay, I'll tell you what exactly it is. So proportion means it will be nothing but A is to B will be equals to B is to C. So now I'm supposed to calculate fourth proportion, means nothing but D value. First proportion means it will be A, second proportion means it will be B, third means it will be C, and fourth means it will be D. I should calculate D value and I have four values here. Okay, so whenever they ask you in terms of proportions, actually you can get two kinds. One is A is to B is equals to C is to D, or you can get it like A is to B is equals to B is to C. You will get four terms or you will get three terms. Okay, so when you get four terms, remember there is a formula, product of extremes will be equals to product of means. Means nothing but the corner terms product should be equals to the product of middle terms. Means if I do AD should be equals to AC. Means if I multiply A into D, that should be equals to B into C. Similarly, for example, this particular problem, you got four terms, so this is fine. If you get three terms, means it will be like this. A is to B will be equals to B is to C. Means at that moment, B square will be equals to AC. Remember this also. They may ask you three terms also. So if they ask you three terms, you should go like this. If they ask you four terms, you should go like this. So now they're asking us four terms and that to fourth proportion. Fourth proportion means the value of D. Okay, so always consider in the exact order. Means A will be 0.06 and B will be 1.2 and C will be 6 divided by 25. So just substitute. A is 0.06 into D should be equals to B is 1.2 into C. C is nothing but 6 by 25. So now you will be having calculators also. You can make use of that. So just send the 0.06 that side. So D will be equals to 7.2 divided by 25 into 0.006. So here we'll get D as 48. So D will be equals to 48. So 48 means option, second option. So answer is 48. Okay, so just remember this one. So you will get four proportions, means four terms, and you will be even getting sometimes three terms also. So you can solve like this. So let's see the next question. So here is the next question. This time there are a more number of questions from ratios. So,
ma'am, can you just show it once again, ma'am? The last sum, like you have solved it. I'll take the pick of that. Yes, ma'am, done. Thank you.
Yeah. So here is the next question. Just give a try. This time there are more questions depending on ratios, actually. Yeah. Just give it a try. Ratio of ages is given and we should find the ratio of their ages after 4 years. Okay. Surya Prakash is saying A. And Surya is also saying A. Okay, Ashmita is also saying A. Fine. So let's see. Shavana option A. Fine. Let's check. So the present ages of three brothers is given. So that is in the ratio of 12:14:7. Means I can imagine first person like A will be some 12x and B will be some 14x and similarly C will be 17x. Okay. So now what is happening? The difference between the ages of the elder and eldest. So first of all, who is elder and who is eldest? So eldest is nothing but 17x, and elder is nothing but 14x, and younger will be 12x, right? So the difference between the ages is 6x, 6 years. Means if I do 17x minus 14x, that should be equals to 6. That implies 3x will be equals to 6, means x value will be 2. So x will be equals to 2 here. That is what we got. Okay. So I got x value is 2. Younger is 12, Nana. Eldest means 17. Elder means 14. So younger will be 12, like that. So x is 2 means A's will be 12. 12x means A will be 24. Similarly, B will be 28 and C will be 17x, means C will be nothing but 34. So this is present ages. But what is our question? We are supposed to find the proportion of their ages after 4 years, means I should calculate after 4 years, means at present 24. After 4 years means A will be nothing but 28. So because 4 years will be added, so A will be 28 and B will become 32. 4 years will be added, so 28 plus 4 will be 32. And similarly for C. Okay, so what will happen for C? 4 years will be added and that will become 38. So this particular ratio I'm supposed to calculate. So A is to B is to C is nothing but 24 is to 32 is to 34. So let's calculate only with 2 it will go. So it will 14 is to 16 is to 19. So 14 is to 16 is to 19, option A. So what's my answer? Option A. Actually, this particular year, the questions are not that difficult. You just need to focus. That's it. So what's the answer? 14 is to 16 is to 19. Yes, Sashmita, 17 and 14 correct. Pooja, option C is wrong. Please cross check once. Okay. So let's see the next question then. I hope everyone is clear. So here, this is a question from simple and compound interest. So even there are few questions from simple and compound interest also. So here is the question. You people give a try first. I will also explain you, but you guys give a try first. Option D. Okay. I think not D. I think it's option C. I think D is correct. Okay, so fine, let's solve. Most of you are saying 250 correct. One thing in simple interest or compound interest, I'll tell you both formulas, you just remember. So first let's say simple interest. Simple interest will be equals to PTR by 100. Okay, this is the formula of simple interest. And remember guys, one thing, amount is different and principal is different. Amount will be equals to simple interest plus principal. Okay, just remember the formulas. Okay, so amount will be equals to simple interest plus principal. For example, if I take 100 rupees, interest occurred on that is 20 rupees. Means I should give him back 120 rupees. That is nothing but amount. 120 will be nothing but amount, and the 100 rupees, whatever you took, that will be principal, and the interest 20 rupees will be interest, like this. Okay, so amount is a different thing and principal is a different thing. So in case interest plus principal will give you amount. If it is simple interest, we'll consider simple interest. If it is compound interest, we'll consider compound interest. Simple interest formula is PTR by 100. I'll just say you compound interest formula also, just remember. So compound interest formula will be equals to P into 1 plus R by 100 whole to the power of N minus 1. So this is the formula of compound interest. N is nothing but number of years. Minus 1 will also come. Remember, most of them just used to take it as P into 1 plus R by 100 whole to the power of N. No, that's wrong. This is the formula of compound interest. Okay. So most of the questions are only on simple interest. Let's see if we have any question on compound interest also. So just remember this formula. Let's all. So here the sum. Sum is nothing but the principal. So principal they took is 1250. And this was going to be taken on 1st January 2016 at 4% simple interest per annum. PA is nothing but per annum. Per annum means it will be for 12 months. Means for 12 months, it is going to be 4%. Rate of interest is 4%, 12 months. Now, what is going to happen here? We are supposed to calculate for 1st July. That's it. I'm not going to calculate entire for 2016. I'm going to calculate only for 1st July. So 1st July, from January to July, how many months are there? 6 months are there. Okay, you don't have to calculate July because July is not completed. July has been started. That's it. Up to July, it will be 6 months. Means time period here is 6 months. Okay, this is the thing you should be a little careful. Time is month here and rate of interest is in terms of per annum. One thing, you convert 6 months to half year and then consider rate of interest as per annum. Or else you convert 12 months, it is 4%, means 1 month it will be 4 by 12%, means 1 by 3%. Okay, so either convert that in terms of months or this in terms of year. Okay, but make sure everything should be like per annum, means this should be in terms of year. If you are considering month, this also should be in terms of month like that. I'm converting in terms of year. So what will be the simple interest? Simple interest is equals to P. P is how much? 12,500 into R is nothing but I'm going to write now in terms of year itself, so which is 4, T is nothing but half year, so 1 by 2 into 4 divided by 100. So 0 zeros will get cancelled, 1s and 2. So 125 into 2 is nothing but 250. So what will be the simple interest? It will be nothing but 250 rupees. But make sure everything should be either in terms of hours or it should be either in terms of years or it should be either in terms of month. 6 by 12 is nothing but 1 by 2, half year. 6 months is half year, so I just consider it as half year nickel. Okay, so that is the only correction that you should remember. That's it. Okay, so let's go ahead to the next question then. So here is the next question. Yes, you guys just give a try. I will also explain. Just give a try. Six hours, Varsha, fine. I hope remaining people are also trying. Okay, so most of you are saying it's option B. I think it would be correct. So let's see. So firstly, here a motorbike is going to have a speed of 60 kilometers per hour. So a motorbike starts at a speed of 60 kilometers per hour. Now the speed is going to increase per 12 kilometer per hour every 3 hours. Means after every 3 hours, 12 kilometer per hour will be increased. Okay. So now, how many hours it will take to cover 480 kilometers is our question. So to cover 480 kilometers, I should carry first how much time it will take. So for that, what I'm going to do is, so firstly, I know my first speed is 60 kilometers per hour. So 60 kilometers per hour, this will carry for 3 hours. Yes. So first 3 hours. So if I take first 3 hours, it will be 60 kilometers per hour itself. But what happened for the next? It will increase 12 kilometers per hour. Means for 60, 12 kilometers will be added. Means it will become 72 kilometers per hour for the next 3 hours. Means for the second set of 3 hours, it will be 72 kilometers. Similarly, if I take next one, it will become 72 plus 12, like 84 kilometers per hour. Like this, it will keep on increasing. Now I'm supposed to calculate only for 480 kilometers. So let's see. So first, it is going to be 3 hours, 60 kilometers. So 3 hours, 60 kilometers means every hour, 60 kilometers. So distance covered here will be 60 into 3, which is nothing but 180 kilometers. So only 180 kilometers is done. Still, we still have 300 more kilometers because we have to cover 480 kilometers, right? So let's see the next one. So what will be the distance covered here? 72 into 3. Yes. So 72 into 3. So 72 kilometers per hour for the next 3 hours. So 72 into 3 means it will give us 216. So here 216, but I should get 480. So first let me add here 180 is done and here 216 is done. So if I consider both of them, then only 396 kilometers is done. But I should complete 480 kilometers, but 396 kilometers is done. Means still 84 kilometers is left. If you look here, per 1 hour, I'm traveling 84 kilometers. Means if I travel 1 hour here, I'll be completing 84 kilometers, right? Already 396 kilometers is done. And if I travel only 1 hour, I'll complete 84. Means 480 kilometers will be done here. By this, I can complete 480. Means first 3 hours here, next 3 hours here, and next 1 hour here. Means total how much time I took? 3 plus 3 is 6, 6 plus 1 is 7 hours. Means total I has took 7 hours to complete 480 kilometers. Yes, option C is correct. So main thing you are just supposed to consider here is only 1 hour. Don't consider 3 hours because only how much we should cover, only 480 kilometers we should cover. And don't consider speed as 60 because here every 3 hours the speed is going to change. Keep that in mind and then you can calculate. Okay. So I hope this question is also clear. So let's move to the next one. So here is the next question. If the perimeter of a rectangle is 82 centimeter and its diagonal is 29 centimeters long, what is the area of the rectangle? So for this, first of all, we should know the formulas. I just say you the formulas, means I'll give you the hint. I want you people to give a try. This is mensuration concept. So perimeter of a rectangle, anyone, what is formula of perimeter? Oh, yes, no one. Fine. So perimeter is nothing but, yes, Dheeraj, correct. 2 into L plus B is perimeter and diagonal. Yeah, most of you could have not known diagonal. Diagonal is nothing but root of L square plus B square. And area is nothing but L into B. So they gave you this two and they're asking you area. Yes, give a try. We have all options here. Yes, 2LB plus 2B is correct. You can take 2 common and you can do also Monica. Just substitute in that, you can actually use one formula, A plus B whole square formula also. Okay. Four 20. Varsha is saying 420. Fine. Good. Okay. So let me solve. So first of all, perimeter was equals to 82. Means 2 into L plus B is 82. By this, I can say L plus B will be 41. Yes. So L plus B will be 41. Okay. Next step. Diagonal is given. This is nothing but 29. Means I can say L square plus B square will be equals to 29 square. Right. So 29 into 21. So 29 into 29 will give us 841. So this is known for us, and I should calculate AB. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply a formula A plus B whole square. So A plus B whole square means nothing but L plus B whole square will be equals to L square plus B square plus 2LB, right? So just applying this, that's it. So L plus B is how much? 41. So 41 square should be equals to L square plus B square, already we know it is nothing but 841. So 841 plus 2LB, right? So by this, I'll get 2LB will be equals to 41 square, means 41 into 41, which is actually 1681 minus 841 will go that side. So minus 841 will give you 840. Okay, so LB will be equals to 840 divided by 2. That's it. 840 divided by 2 is nothing but 420. So what's my answer? 420. Okay, so this kind of questions, actually, you can directly apply A plus B whole square formula. Okay, do you guys understood why I applied A plus B whole square formula? Yes, okay, so... yeah, actually, one more model of this question also appeared. I want you people to try it. Okay, so I'll just say you what is the question is. Actually, this type of models, there are 2 to 3 problems. So this is the question. Area is given this time. Area is nothing but 1260 centimeter square and perimeter is 146 centimeter. And they're asking us to calculate length of diagonal. Length of diagonal. Even this also appeared. Yes, give a try. Dheeraj, what was this? A plus B into A minus B. Was the formula there? A square minus B square is equals to A plus B into A minus B. But how both are related? Why we will calculate A square minus B square? Yes, sir. Try this one. Give a quick try. Let's see who is going to answer fast. Okay, 53, very good. Yes, I think 53 is correct. So it's very simple again. Area is given. Area is nothing but L into B is given. L into B is 1260 and perimeter is given. Perimeter is nothing but 2L plus B. Right, so this is given as 146 means L plus B will be 146 divided by 2 means 73. Just applying the same formula, okay? So same formula means L plus B whole square will be equals to L square plus B square. I'll calculate now. So 2LB. So you can just take this side. So 73 square minus 2 into 126 should be equals to L square plus B square. Yes, so 73 square. You will be having calculator, okay? Don't forget that. So it will give you 5329 minus 126 into 2 will give you 252. So this will give me L square plus B square, but I should calculate area, length of the diagonal, means nothing but root of L square plus B square. So by this, I'll get root of L square plus B square as 5329 minus 252, means nothing but 5077. Yes, so you will be having even square root also there. Okay. Oh, 53.
That is 1260. 1260. 2 into 1260.
Okay. So here 10 is there, right? Okay. Good. Thank you. So here 10 will come. Okay. 7329 minus 2520 will give you 2809. Okay. So 2809 means 53. Yeah. So it will be nothing but root 53. Yes, 53 is correct. Okay, fine. Thank you. So yeah, most of you has answered 53 correct. So let's move to the next equation then. Yes, here is the next equation. So I should calculate pi to the power of x into 3 to the power of y was equals to 225 into 405. That was given for us, and we should calculate this value. So how can you calculate this one? So first step, write 225 and 405 in terms of pi and 3. Okay, Surya may already know the answer. Fine. I don't want you guys to remember the answer. I want you people to try now. So this was given, 5 to the power of x into 3 to the power of y was equals to 225 into 405. So first write 225 and 405 in terms of pi and 3. Yes, I don't want any bi-hatted answers. I want you people to try now. Yes. So first of all, 225. So you can write it in terms of pi and 3, because only pi and 3 is given. So first I'm doing with 3. So this will give me pi 9 means nothing but 3 and 3, right? So this can be written as pi square into 3 square. And similarly, 405. How can I write 405? So first let me do with 5. So I will get with 81. 81 is nothing but 3 to the power of 4. Right, so this can be written as pi into 3 to the power of 4. Yes, sir. So entirely it can be written as pi to the power of 3, pi square and 5 into 3 to the power of 6. So this is nothing but 5x to the power of 3y. That implies x value will be equals to 3. Make the bases same. So bases are same, so powers will be same, right? So y value will be equals to 6. So by using this, we'll get the x value and y value. Now just substitute here. So they're asking us this one. So x is nothing but 3. So they're asking us 3 to the power of 2y, means 2, 6 minus 3 into 3. Okay. So let's see. So 3 to the power of 12 minus 9 will come. So 3 to the power of 3. 3 to the power of 3 is nothing but 27. So 3 to the power of 3 is 27. So answer for this will be 27. Yes. Yes, 3 to the power of 3 is correct. I hope you people understand. Yes, 3 to the power of 3 is correct. Okay, so let's move to the next equation. Okay, so here is the next equation. So here we are going to get a problem from time and work. A can do a piece of work in 72 days. He worked for 8 days and then B finished the remaining work in 48 days. In how many days will A and B together finish the work? Okay, so I want you people to give a quick try. A and B is given 72 days. A can do it in 72 days. He worked for 8 days and then he left. And B is going to do the remaining work in 48 days. So any answers, just leave in the chat box. Option B, good. Okay, I can see very less replies. Option C, fine. Okay, so let me solve. Maybe most of you are not able to get the problem. So first try to understand what is given. A can do a piece of work in 72 days and he is going to complete it for, he worked for 8 days and then B finishes the remaining work in 48 days. That is what they're saying. Okay, so there is one formula in time and work. I'll always use LCM method. There is even unit fraction method also, but I always go with LCM method because that is very easy and comfortable to solve. So faster. So firstly, there is one formula to remember, that is total work will be equals to efficiency.
Ma'am, screen, ma'am.
Sorry?
Screen, ma'am.
Screen is not visible.
Now visible. It is visible, ma'am.
Oh yeah, it's visible, Nana. Even I was using in my mobile. Make sure your internet connection is also good. Okay. So let's see. So first of all, total work will be equals to efficiency into time period. So this is the formula. So remember this formula. Okay. If you can solve this particular problem, almost all models of time and work you can solve. So try to concentrate on it carefully. A can do the work in 72 days. Actually, if A work, he can do in 72 days. He worked for 8 days. So in 72 days, 8 days is completed. Means how many days of A is remaining? 72 days. He worked for 8 days. Means how many days it is remaining? 72. 8 days is done. Means how many days it is remaining? 64 days, right? 72 days total he will take. He worked only for 8 days. Means 64 days is left. So actually if A do, he will take 64 days to do. So efficiency, I don't know. I will just imagine it as A. And time period he will take will be 64. But now what is going to happen? B is going to complete it in 48 days. Means I can say whatever the work done by A in 64 days, that will be equals to work done by B in 48 days. Okay. Here A and B are nothing but their efficiencies. Actually, if A will take, he will take 64 more days to do, but B is going to do it in 48 days. I hope this particular sentence is clear. If this is clear, we can easily solve the entire problem. If A takes 64 days to complete, B is going to take only 48 days. So by this, I can say A by B means nothing but the efficiencies will be in the ratio of 48 divided by 64 means 3/4. This is ratio of their efficiencies. But if you see, time period is already given in our question is 72. So if you look, efficiency and time period are always inversely proportional to each other. Means if A by B, efficiency is 3 by 4. Time period will be 4 by 3. Time period and efficiency will be inversely proportional to each other. Means A by B, if I take time period, it will be like 4 by 3. Means, for example, A will take 4x, then B will take 3x, like this. Okay, only this point you should catch. Now, A is already given as 72 days. Means, for 4x should be equals to 72. That implies x will be 18. Means, B will be 3 into 18. Means, B will be taking only 3 into 18. Means, B will be taking 54 days. Okay, so if A is taking 18 days, B, 72 days, B will be taking 54 days. Okay. But what is my question? They did not ask me how much time B will take. If they ask you how much time B will take, your answer will become 54 and it is very easy. But they are asking us how much time both of them will take. Okay. So both of them, how much time they will take, I should calculate. For that, what we will do is, actually there are again lot of methods to solve this particular problem. So A is going to take 72 days and we calculated B will be taking 54 days, right? So one thing I can find LCM and I can solve, or if you want to go by using unit method, you can just remember this one. If you are going with unit method, time period will be equals to, okay, just remember this one. I'll even say you LCM method also. Time period will be equals to X plus Y divided by XY. Okay, so nothing but actually they will take it as 1 by x plus 1 by y. So that's the reason you will get it as x plus y divided by xy. Means x is nothing but 72 and y is nothing but 54. You can just substitute here and you can calculate the value. Or else what we can do is we can imagine LCM as your total work. Okay, LCM means nothing but 216 will become the LCM and you can imagine that as your total work. So efficiency of A will become 216 divided by 72, whatever the time period it is. Okay, 72 means nothing but 3 and this is 4. Actually, efficiencies are also known here. A is to B is nothing but 3 by 4. Okay, so now they're combiningly working. If they alone work, A will do 3 and if they alone work, B will do 4. Means combiningly how much they will do? They will do 7, right? Total work we already assume that is LCM, which is 216. So 216 divided by 7 will become my answer. So actually 216 will not entirely go. That will become like 36 by 7. 36 by 7 is nothing but option A. Can you explain the ratios part? Yes, Kunal, I'll explain. Actually, I'll explain this entire question one more time, because if you know this particular question exactly, you can solve almost all the problems of time and work. Okay. Yes, for sure. I'll explain it one more time. It's okay even if we consume 2 to 3 minutes of our time, but let's see. Okay. I want all of you to concentrate again. So first thing, if A is going to take 72 days, 8 days is done, means 64 days is left. So 64 days of A. Okay. So 64 days of A should be equals to 48 days of B. Okay, means A by B will be nothing but, this is actually efficiency, 64 days. So actually there is a formula, total work will be equals to duration into efficiency. That is the formula in time and work, duration into efficiency. Efficiency is nothing but per day work, how much he can do. So total work will be equals to duration into efficiency. What I did is, he should do 64 days. One day, I just imagine he may do A units. So one day A units means 64 days, 64 A. And similarly this. So it will become 48 divided by 64, which is nothing but 3 by 4. So A by B efficiency is 3 by 4. Okay. But now what is my question? I'm supposed to find together how many days A will take and B will take to finish the work together. Means I should know first of all how much time they will take. I should know time period. If you look at this formula, total work is equal to duration into efficiency. Duration and efficiency are inversely proportional to each other. This is ratio of efficiency. Efficiency is 3 by 4, means time period ratio will be reverse to that. Means time period A by B will become 4 by 3 because they are inversely proportional, right? So it will be 4 by 3. Okay, so first of all, that will be reverse. Now, if you look at your question, they clearly gave time period of A is 72 days. Look at this one. A by B means nothing but A is to B is 4 is to 3. Okay, 4 is to 3. That implies A will take some 4x and B will be 3x. Actually, it should be like that. But in our question, it is clearly mentioned as 72 days. Means A will be, 4x should be equals to 72. That implies x will be equals to 18. By using this, I got the value of x. And now I'm going to calculate for B. B will be 3x. Means 3 into 18 means it will be 54 days. Means A will take 72 days to complete and B will take 54 days to complete. Individually, they will take 72 and 54 days. But our question is together. Means I should combine both of them, right? You can't directly combine, means you can't directly add it. So first thing, I'll just assume my total work as LCM of them. Total work is nothing but LCM of them, which is nothing but 216. So 216, I'm just imagining that will be my total work. Okay, so 216 is my total work. Now, efficiency, here it will be 3 and here it will be 4, because efficiency is already known for you, 3 by 4. You can directly take, or you can do 216 divided by 72 and 216 divided by 54. Okay, so now time period. So time period will be equals to duration, nothing but duration will be equals to total work divided by efficiency. How much is my total work? I imagine total work is 216 divided by what is my efficiency. Here, both of them are working. Means if A do separately, he will do 3 units. If B do separately, he will do 4 units. If both of them are working, means they will do 7 units. That is the reason I'm just dividing by 7. So 216, actually, it will not directly divide it by 7. So that will give you 36 by 7. 7 trees are is 30, sorry, 21. So 210 divided by 210 and 6 is left. So 6 by 7, like that. Okay. So is that clear? Do you people understand? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we'll solve one more problem in quant and we'll see two problems of logical also. So here is the next one. Yeah, please ignore the voice. I was in home. So actually, I'll tell you what exactly this question is. This is third root nana. Means it is nothing but third root of 4913 divided by 4096 will be equals to 1 plus
alpha divided by previous slide.
Sorry.
Previous slide, ma'am. I'll take screenshot.
I don't understand. Even if you take screenshot, you will be confused with my handwriting, maybe. Is done?
Yes, I'm done.
Okay. Yeah, this is the actual question. This is like third root. Okay. Yeah. You guys give a try now. So third root of 4913 divided by 4096. Should be, actually that was equals to 1 plus, yeah, it is A, not alpha, sorry. A by 16. So we should calculate what is A. Yeah, I think it's correct. Yes, sir. Oh, fine. Let's see. So first of all, how can I calculate what is third root of 413 or third root of 4096? So for that, first check just a small example. For example, if I take 10, okay? So 10 cube is nothing but 10,000. Means nothing but third root of 10,000 will be 10, like this, okay? So this numbers, it's nothing but 1000, sorry. So 1000, it is 10. Okay, so these numbers are more than 1000. Yes, so let me take the next number. For example, if I imagine 20, it will become 600, 20 into 800, sorry, 8000. So that is more. Let me take 15. So 15 into 15 into 15, 215 into 15 means 3375. Means this is more than even that. So let me check with 16. Okay, so this is slightly close than that. So if you see, it is 4096, and this is for 15 cube. So these are close. So I'm checking with 16. So 16 cube. You'll be having calculator. So check with them. So 16 cube means it is 4096. Yes, 4096 means it is for 16. So let me similarly check for 17. Why I'm checking 17 means because this two difference is not so heavy. So 17, if I check, yes, I'll get it as 4913. Means the answers here will be nothing but 17 by 16. So 17 by 16 equals to 1 plus 8 by 16. So one thing you can send them here and you can solve like that, or you can directly do. So let me send it here. So this will be nothing but 17 by 16. 1 will come here and it will become minus 1. So it will become A by 16 will be equals to 1 by 16, means A will be nothing but 1. So what's my answer? A will be 1. Okay, so you should just cross check what will be the value. So I just took 10, it is more than 10. Then I went with 15 and then I did. Okay, you will be even having calculator, so you can easily do what is that value also. Okay. Yeah, so let's see a few questions of logical also now. Just give me 1 second. I'll take the PPT of logical. Yes, I hope the screen is visible, right? Is the screen visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let's see quickly a few of the questions of logical. So here is the first question. So among five people, P, Q, R, S, and T. So there are some statements also given. We are supposed to find among the five who is the heaviest. Okay, means who is the heaviest. So there are statements also given for us. R is twice as heavy as T. So R is twice as heavy as T. So R will be two times as more as T. Okay. And next, S is 1.5 times as heavy as Q, means S will be Q than Q 1.5 times. So it will be nothing but 3 pi 2 times of Q. Okay, and next, R and Q together weight as much as S and T together. Okay, and S together are 1.5 times as heavy as Q and T together. Okay, so what we should find, we should identify who among them is the heaviest. Okay, so you guys give a try. Actually, it's a direct, like a direct hint. Okay, just give me 1 second. I think I have skipped one sentence because there is no relation given for P. So without knowing for P, how can we find? I think I could have missed some part. Okay, just leave this one. I'll check the question and I'll get back with you people. Yes. Here is the next question. Yeah, look at this one. We'll check that one. Now, maybe I have skipped the sentence because P is not given here. Without P, actually, we can't identify who is the heaviest one exactly. So maybe I have skipped some part there. Look at this one. So this is actually a diagram from Venn diagrams. Okay. So here, this 22 is option, na? It's option 22, 20, these are options. Okay, the triangle stands for male. So whatever the triangle is there, that is going to stand for male. The circle for doctors. So whatever the circle is there, that is for doctors. The rectangle is for government employed. The rectangle is for government employees. The hexagon is for corona warriors. The hexagon is for corona warriors. Okay, so now the number in different segments shows the number of person in their segments. Whatever the segments are there, they will show that. How many government employed doctors are either corona warriors or male or both? Or either there should be corona warriors or male or both. Means corona warriors or they can be both. Government employed doctors. So government employee is first of all a rectangle. So rectangle is going to represent the government employee. And the doctors is going to represent by the circle. So circle and government employees mixture. So here, and here. Yes, so these are the only mixtures that should be government employed doctors. So government employee means it will be a rectangle. And that too, doctors means only circle. You can't consider this one because they will be doctors and they may be male. And similarly, this also. Okay, so keep them aside. The government employee and doctor means only the common part you should take. Okay, so first of all, you consider this one. Now what they're saying, either corona warrior or male or both. Corona warrior. So corona warriors is going to be represented in hexagon. Okay, so corona warrior means here 22 and here 16. So this is corona warriors. Okay, or it can male. Male is going to be represented in terms of triangle, right? 73. Good. Okay, let's see. So triangle means it will be 35. Okay, I should not consider 14 now because this is only this is only doctor and employee. That should be corona warriors, male or both. Both means it can be even combination of them. Means 35 is going to satisfy, 22 is also going to satisfy, and even 16 is also going to satisfy. If I take any of these numbers, if for example, if I take this 35, this is going to stand in male, doctor, and government employee. So I can consider 35 because that is male, doctor, and government employee. If I see corona warrior, it is 16. If I see both combination, it is 22. So here both combination is there. Means combiningly, all of this will give me the entire answer. So let me add. So 16 plus 35 plus 22, which will give me 73. So what's my answer? It is 73. Yes, 73 is correct. So you should just add them. You should just check where all of them are going to mix. Yes, good. 73 is correct. Ashmita, yes, 73 is correct. Okay. Fine. So let's see the next one. So here is the next question. Actually, you got a little bit more number of questions like this. I want you people to give a try first. So certain codings is given. M plus N means M is the son of N. M is the son of N. M into N means N is the brother of M. M divided by N means M is the husband of N. So N minus M, all of this is given. So we are supposed to form first for this, and then we should find which of the following is true. Yeah, you guys just give a try. I'll explain you, however. T minus P means T is the sister of P, like that. So let me solve this. So first, female I will be representing in terms of a circle, and male I'll be representing in terms of a square. Okay, so next generations are like this. Yes, Nagesh is saying T. Fine, let's see. So T minus P. So T minus P means T is sister of P. So T is a girl and she is sister of P. You can't say the gender of P now itself, so keep P aside. Okay, so I can't say the gender of P firstly. Next up, P plus Q I should take. P plus Q means P is son of Q. Now I can say P is a boy and he is son of Q. Okay, so P is son of Q. So firstly, they are saying P is a girl and sister of P, and P is a boy and he is son of Q. Okay, Q gender you can't take. Q into R, which of the following is true? Okay, most of you are saying D. Let me check. Q into R. Q into R means nothing but Q into R means Q is brother of R. So Q is a boy and he is a brother of R. They are not married actually, they are brothers. Okay, R is R divided by S. R divided by S means R is husband of S. R is husband of S means definitely S is going to be a girl. R is husband of S means definitely S is going to be a girl. So this relation is known for us. These two are brothers. So these two are brothers and these two are married, and the Q's children are this. Q is son of S. P is son of S. No. Q is uncle of P. No. He is father. And S is sister of Q. No. That is us. Brother-in-law for S. Q will become brother-in-law. Yes, S is aunt of Q. T. Yes, S is aunt of T. Correct. So what's the answer is correct? Yes, option D is correct. Good. Option D is correct. Okay, so here is one more. Yes, give a try for this also. Same kind of model. Okay, everyone is saying option C. Good. Let's check quickly. So A plus B means A is husband of B. So A is a boy and he is husband of B. Okay, so B minus C means B is daughter of C. So B is daughter of C, and C divided by B means C is wife of D. So that is what they gave. Now, C is mother of A. No, C is mother-in-law of A. So this is wrong. D is the mother of B. D is the father of B, actually, not mother. D is father of B. Yes, correct. So option C is correct. Very good. Yes, C is correct. Yes, we'll do one more here. So this is going to fall under the category of data sufficiency. So how Seema is related to Ram? So they're asking one question and they gave us two statements. Now I'm supposed to find which statement is enough for me to answer the question. Ram has brother Mohan. Mohan is the son of Rahul. Seema is Rahul's sister. So that is statement one. Next case, Rahul is father of Ram and brother of Seema. Okay. So next. So there are some state we are supposed to find. Either one is enough or either two is enough, like that. So you guys say me what will be the answer, then I'll say you what will be the exact answer. Yes, Patan is saying option A. Okay, yes, A. Either indicates by using statement one, you can answer. Even by using statement two also, you can answer. And look, you should find the relation between Seema and Ram. Yes. Yes, correct. Actually, Ram is the brother of Mohan. There is actually no necessary event to form. We can actually directly say Ram is the brother of Mohan. Mohan is the son of Rahul. Rahul, Seema is the Rahul sister. Yes, by this I can definitely find what is relation between them. Yes, and even if I look at this one, Rahul is the father of Ram. Ram's father is Rahul and brother of Seema. Yes, again I can find by using both the statements, either by using the first one or by using the second one also I can find. So at that moment my answer will become either. There is lot of difference between both statement and either, so be careful. Both means whenever you combine you will say it as both, whenever you do separately we'll say it as either. Okay, so be careful with that. So I think now you will be having technical. Yeah, so we'll stop here. I'll wish you all the very best for your examination. It has been postponed for your good luck. Maybe you'll get a lot of time to practice now. So even practice for technical and verbal. And don't get depressed. Even if the exam is not going fine, we have even Wipro, we have even Accenture, everything. But do your best. All the very best for your examination.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, Nana. Yes. Yeah. The next meeting link will be sent for you. Okay. So you can join there. My name is Pujita Yasin. Pujita Renati. Yes, correct. Yes, Ashmita, bye.